What is the meaning of life? What do we as humans search for? Why do we as humans take our own lives? These are all questions we are faced with as human beings. How can we find these answers, or at least, how can we find something to help us understand more? Film. Film is an amazing way to gain a better understanding of these questions we all seek the answers to. When I wanted an answer to these questions, the films I went to were The Perks of Being a Wallflower and Fight Club. Why? Well, because both of these films use an incredibly unique style, which is the first-person narrative. This style has always intrigued me because when you're hearing a story told through the character, it helps engulf you in this world in which they live in. And I myself shall be utilizing this style in my own short film because I believe, for the genres I'm basing my film around, it will greatly complement it. The Perks of Being a Wallflower is a coming-of-age drama. It tackles very serious problems that many young adults faced with in today's society. The main style in this film is first-person narrative, as it's focused on the main character, Charlie, and how he talks through his point of view of depression and PTSD from when he was sexually assaulted by his aunt when he was a child. Charlie's birthday is on the 24th of December, and on this day, his aunt left to get him a present when she was involved in a fatal car accident. Charlie blamed himself for her death, and it haunts him throughout his life. Charlie's best friend kills himself a year before the film takes place, and this also contributes to Charlie's depression and PTSD. First-person narrative is a style of film that focuses on the main character's point of view and the way they see the film through their eyes. Lighting and color. While the prior scene, the scene I shall be focusing on, is very bright and the color palette is very alluring and almost beautiful, as Charlie approaches his house, this bright, inviting light begins to fade as he slowly approaches his former, darker self. Charlie enters his house and we immediately see an absolute switch in lighting, with the house only being lit by the faint sun glaring through the windows. Charlie's life has returned to darkness. The walls around the house almost feel darker, colder, less vibrant as they were when Charlie had started to gain confidence and feel happy. But now that he's lost it all, this color he started to see in the world is lost. As we see Charlie approach his room, the lighting makes the viewer feel discomfort, as the character we have grown to love and almost changed with is returning to the dark life he once lived. Charlie's room feels as if it lacks the life that it once had, just like he slowly does in this scene. The walls feel dull and bare, as if there's something missing. This color palette and the lighting styles used when the director is trying to convey a sense of pain, loss, or suffering. But now let's swap to a scene with a much different lighting style and color palette. The scene from Fight Club, where the narrator and Marla look off from the skyscraper to the explosions going off caused by Tyler Durden and his Fight Club. This scene is almost completely dark, with the only light coming from the vibrant city lights in the background. The narrator and Marla are only shown as dark silhouettes and are facing away from the camera, but as the explosions go off and watch the towering skyscrapers fall to the ground, the lighting becomes much brighter and almost energizing. The colors that are shown are absolutely beautiful, as the swap from a dark building to a blazing city appearing to fall beneath our eyes is truly amazing. The swap from darkness to bright oranges and reds is perfect and seals the movie amazingly. Sound. Sound in a film is absolutely one of the most important parts to me, and I believe it is to many others as well. There's a range of sounds that can make the viewer feel uncomfortable, happy, and many more emotions. To start off, let's take a look at the sounds in Fight Club. As the narrator and Marla look off into the distance, the song Where Is My Mind by the Pixies begins to fade in. And as the build-up of the song progresses, the viewer gains a sense of excitement, as we know that as the song reaches the climax, the film will too. And while there may be no diegetic sounds throughout this whole scene, the words of the song almost tell a story, what is going through the character's mind, and what and makes us feel that we don't need to get attacked because we understand that. Now let's take a look at the sounds from The Perks of Being a Wallflower. The scene that I focus on has a strange mix of sounds. In the background, there is a calming piano playing that makes the viewer feel relaxed, at home. But throughout the scene, the words and sounds that we hear are disturbing and scary. Why do they do this? Well, to answer this question, it's because that's how Charlie feels. Charlie has found his love, Sam, but now that she has left him, he is flooded with a mix of emotions, ranging from happiness that they've shared their feelings for each other, to sadness and regret that they've only shared them the day before she leaves for college. Repeatedly through the scene, we hear Charlie say, "It's my fault," because he blames himself for the death of his aunt. This repetition of the words, "It's my fault," goes louder and more harsh as the scene progresses, showing the build-up to Charlie's mental breakdown. Charlie also tells himself, "Stop crying," because throughout this film, he's been stopping, or to put it more accurately, suppressing these emotions. And now that he has nothing or no one to distract him, he is faced with more emotions than he can handle, and subsequently begins to cry. The mix of non-diegetic and diegetic sounds perfectly come together to create a sense of displacement, Charlie, and suffering, replicating how Charlie feels. Focus. In any film, there is always a focus, a specific thing or person that stands out, that is special compared to everything else. In The Perks of Being a Wallflower, Charlie is always in focus, and even in scenes with many people, there will always be a blurred or faded effect on the others, while Charlie remains clear and visible throughout the scene. Charlie is the focus. He is the one that needs to be seen. But why? Well, because throughout this film, Charlie is the narrator. Charlie is the one who we hear the whole story told by, so he needs to be the one we see the most. When a film is told in the first person, the character that is speaking is the one who we will be observing and focusing on. Fight Club has relatively the same focus, but with a little twist. Tyler Durden and the narrator are both the focus of the film, but in many scenes with Tyler Durden and the narrator, they are both in equal grounding and have equal status. But once the truth comes out that Tyler Durden is merely a fabrication of the narrator's imagination, it leads the viewer to think, was Tyler Durden ever truly the focus of the film? Because he never existed. Well, the answer is yes and no. Yes, because when we as the viewer see Tyler Durden in some scenes, it is the persona, Tyler Durden, in control of the narrator's body. But other times, the narrator's in control. So the factual answer would be no, because Tyler Durden is the narrator. So only the narrator is in focus. But if we look at it from the viewer's point, Tyler is the main focus alongside the narrator. Framing. The framing in The Perks of Being a Wallflower is one of the very subtle yet gorgeous ways in which they show Charlie's state of mind. In the scene in which Charlie is walking back from Sam's house, we see multiple Charlies in frame. This shows his loss of self and his disassociation, as if he has become a different person. When he enters the house, the camera takes an awkward angle, with Charlie being looked down upon and skew because of this awkward positioning of the camera. As Charlie walks up and approaches the corridor, the framing is very tight, and Charlie is shown walking down the corridor, almost unaware that he is. He is lost in thought, in the endless depth of painful thoughts. When he gets to his room, he sits in front of the typewriter, which is given by Sam, but he has nothing to write. His mind is completely absent. Charlie's in the middle of the frame, with his back facing the viewer. Prior scenes, Charlie faces the camera, showing that he is gaining his confidence and that he is happy. But in this scene, he has turned his back on the audience. He has lost his will to live. In conclusion, throughout both these amazing films, we hear the story through the eyes of the characters that we focus upon, and this helps us grow with them, feel what they truly feel. Throughout my short film, I want to utilize this to help the viewers understand my character's state of mind and what is going through his head, and what he is thinking leading up to the film's climax. Also, like the final scene in Fight Club, I want to utilize dark lighting to emphasize the character's silhouettes, because I believe this is one of the most elegant and easy, yet amazing film techniques that is rarely used in modern film. The final style from these films that influenced me in the making of mine is the use of awkward camera angles and shots. This shows unease that the character is experiencing. These shots are so unique because not many modern films utilize it, because it is very experimental. All of this must be enough for you to fall in love with my true love, film.